Right, welcome back to the View from the Allotment End, episode 4, part 2. We're indebted to Humber Social Club once again for hosting us this evening. Many thanks to them. Free beer again.
Sponsors of the Tin Pot Podcast.
Newly named Tin Pot Curtis Woodhouse Memorial Podcast.
Memorial?
What are you Memorial.
Rest in pieces.
What's he starting on? You on? Part two, we're going to talk all things Hull City. There's been a lot going on, even this early stage of the season. And not least of all, a new manager, probably one of the worst kept secrets that Marco Silva wouldn't stay. He has consequently gone, and the new manager is Leonid?
Slutsky?
Leonid Slutsky? Yeah. Slutsky. Slutsky. Is that right? What do we know about Mr. Slutsky?
I think there's been tons of articles, isn't there, and all the press and all anybody's found out so far is that he fell out of the tree. Was trying to rescue a cat and hurt his knee.
I think somebody said on Twitter, didn't they? There's been a lot written about him, but nobody really knows an awful lot about him.
No, because
there's been a lot of ways with an actual Slutsky.
I think he must have fallen on his head, actually.
Don't come in here thinking it's win
against. I saw that one yesterday.
I missed that one.
His win record looks good though.
Yeah. I mean, I think the fact he wants to be is a big positive, isn't it? Because there's talk of him taking English lessons on it for like 8 hours a day.
Yeah, I mean, he's clearly been planned to come to England.
He wants a job, doesn't
he? Yeah, he wants a job. He wants a job in England. He's been out and about, he's been learning English, he's been watching football. And the problem is people just don't know that much about
Where's he coming from? From Russia?
Yeah, he's been doing two jobs up to last summer. CSKA in Moscow,
yeah,
who he'd been at for 7 years, and then he took the Russia job when they were struggling to qualify for the Euros. Rescued their campaign, and then they had an atrocious final. So he chucked Russia, and then he quit CSKA in December.
Right.
So kind of in the break between Champions League. So I think there's been an interview with him, which some Russian guy's been translating, and it's probably offered a little bit more insight into him. I have read it. One of the things he says was he wanted to leave last summer. He was sort of ready for a new challenge, a bit of a rest. Found the pressure of managing CSKA and trying to succeed in Russia, where basically they don't finish first or second, which would be a disaster. So it's a bit like managing Chelsea over here. He found that a hell of a pressure and he wanted to do something different, so he kind of regrets hanging about for that 6 months. But regardless, he's here. I think it's an interesting appointment. I think it's an exciting appointment. I would have been absolutely gutted if we'd got some absolute moron who's failed everywhere he's been and he's still getting jobs.
Stink that.
Well, I was thinking David Moyes,
but we've got this, Nigel Atkins.
Yeah,
Nigel Pearson.
Yeah,
Alapadu.
Nigel Atkins.
A long time ago.
Yeah, nobody on this podcast is defending Nigel Atkins.
So it was getting that bad that people say, I have Phil Brown back.
Yeah, that was an interesting one. I never saw that. I've seen a few people make that shot. I've never kind of really seen why he's kind of good enough to come back.
I didn't think he was the worst option. I think the thing with Phil Brown is he just got to play. And that's, he's kind of, he was always really into Hull. He was great.
A bit too much, yeah. It was always infectious with Phil Brown.
It was, yeah. It'd be great for City Culture, Phil Brown. It'd be brilliant. They'd be doing painting, they'd be doing stripping, they'd be doing all sorts of film.
Stripping?
I didn't mean wallpaper.
And with Barry Venison no longer on television, at least you get stupid jacket from somebody.
No, so I just think he is an out of box appointment. it's a guy who's been successful, like Neil said. He's got a great win record because he's been like the biggest club in Russia, been doing a Russian national job. But it just, there's just so much uncertainty, like we talked about for Ferriby previously in the first part. We don't know who he's going to have left. We don't know how many players he needs. I think he said in this interview that he's given can't say too much because the club manage the messages I'm putting out, but five or six minimum. And
in?
Yeah, in. Five or six, he was saying, at least, and I think that's a lot.
As well as replacing the one with the girl.
Well, exactly. Yeah, five or six will be replacing the one with the girl in the future. So I think you could be looking at 10 plus.
Talking of which, the departures have already started.
Curtis Davis has gone.
Curtis Davis already gone.
Yeah.
Talk tonight of one of the young reserve team players.
Tam. Oh, Harvey Rogers.
You're the one with Rogers.
Yeah, Harvey Rogers is going. I think that's less of an immediate worry.
And Simon, who, like you say, broke through sort of last season, so be handy addition in the Championship.
Well, so Tom Hulston as well, at weekend West Brom.
Yeah, well, it's easy to name a lot of them, to be fair, but I think Maguire and Robertson are very seriously close to going. Josh Tynan, from what I've heard, is going to have a stroke. That's going to happen. The rest, I think, there's a lot of maybe.
Yeah,
a lot of them have got release clauses.
It's not a huge amount of money for a player of his kind of experience. No. Focus put on it
the worry about some of the others to me is I think you need to get rid of the ones who want to go, and you need to get the money in, and you need to rebuild. The worry for me with guys like Hunston would be they're the ones when it comes to August 30th, someone like Burnley or Watford hasn't got a player. And that's when they'll start coming in for a Huddleston or a Dawson, and then you've got no time to replace him. So it's a hell of a challenge. Definitely, it's a hell of a challenge because I think he needs to find a lot of players from nowhere. We don't know what his budget is. A lot of people are getting excited about Chelsea youngsters coming in because of the links with Roman Abramovich, but that's difficult to get. A, players who want to come north, players who want to come win the Championship, and you've seen the real creme de la creme. At Chelsea, they're not going to be playing for us, they're going to be going.
You're looking for the Abrahams, aren't you?
Exactly, Abrahams. We're going to be in the Championship getting Abrahams next season.
No, you're looking for
the Premier League club's going to take it. And that'll be the same with all of the real top youngsters, you know, Christiansons and Chalabars. They'll all be going, if not to Premier League clubs, to top European clubs. So it's an avenue, but I don't think it's an open goal.
Yeah, you've got to factor in the fact he doesn't know the Championship as well, I mean, which kind of can go either way, I guess, can't it? I mean, he'd be able to do his own back and prepare, but it's still a massive culture shock of it.
Do we think there's been like a dumbing down almost of the Premier League to the point where players like you mentioned no longer need to go into the Championship for loan moves? Who was the lad that went to Middlesbrough? What's his name?
Bamford.
You know, that kind of scenario where he's hot in the Championship and perhaps not so much in the Premier League. Do we think now there's more opportunity in the Premier League? Now we haven't got quite the bigger team, shall we say. Are you going to want to get an opportunity at Bournemouth as you are at a Hull City or a Leeds United or a Sheffield United or a whoever?
Yeah, I think that's an interesting point. I mean, there are a lot of clubs in the bottom half of the Premier League now who aren't big clubs.
Yeah.
And they're filling their squad with players. They want 25 players, the same as everybody else. But they're going out and they're looking again, like you said, everybody's looking below, looking at the top Championship players they can bring in, they're looking at somebody who's going to be free at a Championship club, and then looking at those players. So that loan market is massive. And I think the other thing as well is, up to last season, players could go to the Championship, couldn't they? And they could go for on an emergency loan. Now the transfer window rule exists for everybody. If you're going to go, you've got to go for 6 months. You can't. You can't see how it's going at your club, see whether you get in the squad for the League Cup early rounds and then go on an emergency loan for 3 months before Christmas. You've got to commit, you've got to do it early. So it is a bit of a changing environment. But I'm not so worried as Nick about him knowing the Championship. I think that's slightly overrated. I know some managers do come in, foreign managers, and the Championship chews them up. But, you know, last season there was a lot of foreign managers who made the Championship look easy. And the season before, in fairness, the kid at Sheffield Wednesday, the kid from Portugal, Carvajal, Wagner, last season at Huddersfield came and got promoted. And people are looking at that model now. Reading did well with Yapstam, didn't they? Norwich have already gone out and they've literally copied Huddersfield by getting Borussia Dortmund's reserve team manager. I think it's a changing league, and it will keep changing while more foreign players come into the Championship, more foreign managers come in. Become a bit like a Premier League.
Premier League.
But it's going to be a tough league, I think. It always is. But I don't think there's like a real big club in there this year. They don't look to me like anybody who's any better than anybody else.
Yeah, no, you've maybe got some Middlesbrough have a decent start.
Yeah, they're like big squad together.
With Gary Monk in charge.
Do you think most of the City's recruitment will come from the continent?
I don't know. Because, I mean, it clearly did under Silver, and Silver had a lot of contacts, and the agent that he uses had a lot of contacts, but it's a bit difficult, because I don't think Skupski can go out and bring in players he's worked with before.
No.
Because when you look at who plays in Russia, obviously a lot of Russians, who would need... shock horror. Who would need wet pellet?
Yeah,
and a lot of Brazilians and African players who were there, who, you know, will also need work permits. And also, CSKA is a big club. All the top teams, they're in the Champions League, they pay massive wages. Yeah. They ain't letting players go for championship money. I think there's a kid, Golovin, at CSKA, who asked, I'm trying to buy him, what, 10 million for him. That's going to be the market. So I think it's going to be difficult.
Do you think maybe lower down in the Russian league?
Yeah, possibly. I mean, he might know some players, but like I said, it's going to be difficult for him to get work permits, I think, to bring players over. Unless, you know, they get some Brazilians with some dodgy passports.
Yeah, some European relatives.
I really don't know, to be honest. I don't think anybody knows. We haven't been linked with that many players in, have we?
No, not particularly. Yeah,
I've seen a lot of Josh Windus today,
Scott Arfield from Burnley, which, the thing that bothers me for City, it always seems to be so-and-so trying to buy this player, and there's competition from Hull City. It's never City
City are in
for him, yeah. It's always somebody's in for him, and our name's been used to put his wages up or whatever. So, very, very difficult point of the season, really. Just got to wait and see what he does. But
and it is only middle June.
One thing I would say, the last thing I'll say, they've done it early. That's a big difference on last season.
That's right.
They've got him in. It's June. He's got, 3 weeks now before the players come back from pre-season. That's a massive improvement.
Yeah, I've got some Palace Twitter friends, and they've sort of been running the fact that the state's kind of got a permanent manager. And, you know, it's ticking on. At least we have got somebody in.
Yeah.
It's just a case of whether they can do the business.
I think we said last time, didn't we? I think we said the pre-season is going to be massive.
Oh, absolutely.
It's important. It's important. It's a better pre-season than what it was last year.
And we've got to get a strategy of how they're going to approach things. I mean,
I think some of the players on the league as well, we've known for a long time, haven't we?
The one thing I will say is, over the last 2-3 summers, apart from Modiani, who had the release clause in his contract, and obviously the same with Kevin Davis because they had the release clause, everybody else, I think they've got good money from. So they've got good money for like Chester and Brady when they went for Livermore and Snodgrass in January, you know, got 10 million.
But is it more the fact that they got rid of them than getting good money for them?
Well, I don't think you can stop it, can you, for that, James?
You can.
It's difficult. Yeah, I mean, the problem is, there's two things. I mean, last time when we got relegated, they wanted some money in because they want to offset the massive loss in revenue from the Premier League. So that's going to happen. Whereas everything the last sort of six months, 12 months has been about players running out of contracts. And that's, in effect, I mean, that isn't good management of a club, letting a player get down, like they've done with Maguire and Robertson, letting them get down to 1 year.
Yeah.
That's stupid. But the one thing they do is the one thing they do is get a good fee at the end of the day. So I look stupid when it comes out that Andy Robertson's gone for 3 million or something. But to this point, like I say, apart from the release clause, they have got good money in for players.
You never see the expression "sell on" clause with City unless they're actually paying it.
No, well, I mean, there's been a few, but I mean, a lot of the players we've been selling have been at the top end of the market, top end of the
year. Bingo's place does get a selling clause, isn't it?
Is, yeah.
I mean, is there anything due in terms of Kearney being moved on?
Kearney, yeah, well, he's, no, we've already had to sell him top end because he went from Blackburn to Fulham. Yeah, so we sold him for about £500,000.
Yeah, was it 20 million?
Yeah, 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 and then he, well, he went to Fulham, I think, for 4.5 million, and we got 600 grand of that. So we've had 1.1 million for him-ish, and now Newcastle offering 20, so... Yeah.
I don't think that's a criticism of the club, is it? Because I think at the time that he left, he didn't look a player was really big one, did he? It looked like he needed to move on at the time, didn't he?
In fairness, I mean, there were some people at the time who thought he should.
Yeah,
he thought he had talent, but I wasn't one of them.
Evening, Tom.
No, I absolutely love the guy, but I just thought at the time he was stagnant. He wasn't taking any opportunity that came his way. And we'd just gone into the Premier League and signed Tom Huddleston and Jake Livermore. And, you know, he isn't a £20 million player if he stayed at Old City three years ago, because he spends the first season sat on the bench. He spends the next season out on loan at, I don't know, Blackpool or something. Yeah. And, you know, does anybody go out on loan and really galvanise themselves? Yeah. And you probably find that this summer, instead of him being a £20 million player at Fulham, City released him on a free transfer. Yeah. And he's got squad, I don't know.
I think at the age he was at when he was at City, he needed games.
Ultimately. Yeah, well, I think he had the opportunity, didn't he? He's never really kind of grasped it, did he? He tends to play that kind of slow, laid back style, didn't he? But never even dictated the game.
Was he a better man than Nicky Featherstone, do you think?
He was a good player, but
he had talent, didn't he?
Where he did have talent. Whether
it was a feeling of the club to kind of harness it in the right way and kind of, you know, bring the best of him out in terms of tactical decisions, I don't know, but. I think he did reach the point where we had to do it, didn't he, really, for his own career, and you have to give him full credit for turning himself into a
player. Could we blame that on a turnover of managers sometimes?
Maybe not
sometimes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I always look back, and, right, we've defended Nigel Atkins on the app, so, all right, let's have a go at Ian Dowling.
This
is going to be a good one, isn't it? Hey,
we're not printing out any masks.
We print
the cut techie.
When we got when we got relegated the first time from the Premier League, we came down and Ian Dowie had been bringing through Mark Cullen, Liam Cooper, Will Atkinson, and Tom Kearney had just been established under Phil Brown. And when we came down, I thought we've got four players there who are going to be, you know, no matter what we come down, we had a right collection of riffraff coming into the Championship. Like we always do. City can't get relegated from the Premier League and be stable, can they? About as stable as the government. Yeah. So,
topical.
Politics free zone here.
So we came down and I thought we've got four kids there who are going to be the backbone of this team. And then you're right, turnover manager and Nigel Pearson comes in. And, you know, as much as you want that bad, but you've got players like Nobby Solano coming in and James Harper coming in. And,
yeah.
You know, and these people are playing ahead of. And the only one who really had a go at bringing the kids back into it was Nick Barmby. And then he went, Steve Bruce came in, and Cooper and Kelly went, and the rest is history, isn't it? So, it is, at the end of the day, it is what it is. So you look back now, I mean, when Tom Kelly, if he does go for 20 million plus, you know, he might top himself. So.
Did I mention the time I played against Nick Barmby?
No.
I don't remember that packet.
Did you?
16, 17?
Oh, right. Yeah, no, but he was about five at the time.
I've given him a couple of years, but yeah.
I think with no disrespect to Tom Kearney, there's a lot of inflated prices about is it Pickford, the Sunderland keeper, which is probably
£30 million
today.
Well, the record is 18 with 12 million add-ons.
I think goalkeepers were a bit undervalued because there was as crucial as a strike, right? You can get 20 goals a season. You can get a goalkeeper.
Yeah.
So was going to keep you, you know, whatever, 15 clean sheets.
Oh, Robbie Watson.
Yeah, I think they might be the money for.
Well, they might be, but the problem is, I think if you look at what Barcelona have got Ter Stegen, Atletico Madrid have got Jan Oblak, and somebody else, I think about the guy at Real Madrid, and the three of them together didn't cost what Joe Pickford is going to cost. That is the level of inflation. And they are inflated, aren't they? I think, I mean, I'm a massive fan of Rodriguez, the Swiss left-back. He's just gone to AC Milan for, I think it's €15 million, so, like that.
£15 million?
Yeah.
So we're not in politics, are we?
We're not in politics, yeah. And then you look, Ryan Bertrand's been linked with Man City for 25
years. Yeah.
Yeah. Sorry, you know, it's just, yeah. they're not even close to being the same player. But, so, yeah, that's the market City are in to try and find these gems. So, like Neil said earlier, if they do look abroad, that'll be why, because that's where they're moving.
Yeah. Right, sorry, now,
my one worry is that with the success of bringing our Polish winger Grzycki, and the fact that we're actually hearing Polish people in the stands now, I just wonder that it's not going to be going through the electoral rail and saying, he looks like he's Bulgarian. Really? Who do you know in Bulgaria?
No. This implies that an element of planning is going into the process, doesn't it? I'm not really sure.
Yeah, a league of nations of who, you know, what nationalities live in Hull.
Yeah, well, we've got plenty.
Well, he's got from that stadium somewhere.
Yeah.
Well,
you won't do that. I don't understand. Yeah. Right, I think we've overrun on the Hull City section. Rick is starting up a podcast.
Yeah.
I was going to mention it, but you can fuck off now. Do you want to let the viewer in on what the podcast is?
I'm doing a new podcast called Hull City Heroes, which is just reflecting on Hull City Heroes, funnily enough. So I've got some ex-City players lined up to talk about their teammates, hopefully give us a bit of a different insight, and then just some fans like we've got here. So I think Nick's already lined up to come on, because Nick's a voice for hire.
Media
hall. Very reasonable rates.
Yeah.
City ambassador.
So you've got to have an advice favourite on, haven't you? Yeah. So I hope we've put together a collection of voices, male, female, young, old, and look at different ages and ranges of players. So at the moment, I'm trying to put together a pod on Billy Whitehurst, which goes back to early 80s, and then I'm trying to put together one on Giovanni, which ends up to about 2010. So if it's successful, then hopefully we'll do all of the top City players of the last 30, 40 years. And if it isn't, there'll be two recorded. Please download them.
Do you want to mention the Facebook, Twitter?
Yeah, it's on Twitter, at Hull City Heroes, so you can go and find that, and it will be hullcityheroes@podbean.com, and hopefully iTunes if you come back out to do it.
Okay, brilliant. Right, we'll edit that fucking shit out later on here. I'm getting advertised on my podcast. I think that's it, we're done for the City section.